Hey Lee, in here.
Hello. Hey Ken.
Hey Lee, you're actually signed in as you.
Amy, well, or I was quick on the draw.
I can't tell you how often I log in as like some random other account. It's great.
I'm thinking about changing my first name to Austin, just so it there's no confusion. See, Ed, I'm about to do it. See, this is like my every fiber in my body wants to do that. yeah.
Yeah, I'm amused, but no, not quite. It could be worse. We actually have a second Ed Warnicki at Cisco whose name differs from mine by one character, who's an account. He's basically a sales guy in New York. So for 20 years, we've been getting each other's pages, meetings, and emails.
I can imagine those look quite different, actually.
Yeah, it's usually easy to tell from context.
Yeah. Speaking of Cisco, I was just, that's a topic I should catch up with you on. I was having a small interchange with Mike Dvorkin.
Always a fun guy.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, very good. Hey, we're 3 minutes after.
He certainly does not suffer from personality deficiency syndrome.
He has interests and he's not afraid to show those. He also has, opinions that are, emboldened in gold and solid truth.
So the best version of that I ever heard, which did not come from him, it came from Dave Ward, was the statement, strong opinions repeated emphatically.
As opposed to like strong opinions loosely held, which is fair enough. I guess we were about four after. If you're in attendance and your name isn't in the meeting minutes, please jot down your name. Good to have everyone. It's been a little while since we've met. Let's get rolling because we're about four after. So a couple housekeeping items. One, this is a CNCF special interest group call, and as such, we. Expect everyone treats people with respect. We also record our calls. Our meeting minutes are public, and so are our calls. With that, if you do have a topic today, we do have room on the agenda to entertain new topics. So now is a good time to bring yours up or list it in the topics here, and we'll cover it. For those that may not have been on one of these calls before, and because it's been a little while since we've met, a couple of things that a few other housekeeping items. One, there's a few chairs here that spend their time trying to help steward these discussions. So Matt Klein of Lyft is with us. Ken Owens of MasterCard is here. And my name's Lee of Layer 5. The three of us are here trying to help. Actually, it's a good moment to welcome others to introduce if you're up for it. I see a few familiar faces and some others that we may not have gotten a chance to meet. If anyone's inclined to say a couple of words to introduce, please do. Fair enough. We have a short agenda today, so we'll see where this takes us. Many of us are probably hoping that it takes us 15 minutes. And then the first one is something that we've been talking about for a while and that we had surfaced, that we've been socializing and trying to garner interest around. And I think we've got more than enough interest to go ahead and hold a set of discussions that are service mesh specific. The CNCF SIG network has service mesh as a technology in its, you know, in its scope, but is not the only focus of CNCF SIG network. As such, though, service meshes are a relatively newer, relatively younger area, have lots of topics to cover. And so what I wanted to do today, if we could, is make a call for to establish a meeting time, or maybe even to ask this question a little bit differently. And that is that we'll click into this link here and we'll kind of look at the initiatives that have been defined and kind of the topics of conversation for that working group. As we look over those, I think that there's two questions that I'd like to ask. Is one is, do we, as we move forward with those meetings and those initiatives, do we want to use this time for those items, or do we want to reserve this time for our general discussions, for our project reviews and presentations, and meet separately on the service, on the service mesh working group? Hold that in the back of your mind while we take a look at while we take a look over these things. There's a few slides in here. As a matter of fact, I think they're accidentally duplicated. A number of you have seen these before, and so it is not my intention to fill the air with my voice. Rather, to cruise over these very quickly and say that there are really any number of participants behind the topics that we're going to be discussing. And so we need to identify a meeting time. So the many of you are familiar with the SMI, which is a sandbox project sort of within scope of SIG network. That SMI has been I don't know. I'll do some ad lib just because I think it's probably helpful context for a lot of people. SMI has been enjoying a lot of adoption recently. We saw adoption announced yesterday, somewhat prominently from a new service mesh, open service mesh, coming from Microsoft. It is also not the only service mesh that will be announced this year that will prominently support SMI. So kudos to that project. I think it's doing well, picking up pace. One of the initiatives that we want to move forward in context of both the SMI meetings within this working group is something specific to SMI. So rather than talk about the other specifications for the moment, let's talk about some NSMI specific chunk of work. The CNCF participates in Google Summer of Code. CNCF also participates in Community Bridge. Community Bridge is a little bit more than a mentoring and internship program, but that is a component of what Community Bridge is. So there's a Google Summer of Code and a Community Bridge, a couple of interns that are working on this conformance tool, which was presented at yesterday's SMI call. It's a conformance tool, very similar to Sonoboy. So what Sonoboy is to Kubernetes, this conformance tool built into Meshery is that, runs a suite of tests. It stands up six different types of service meshes, those that are participating in SMI, runs a battery of tests against them, collects the results. It also guarantees the provenance of the results so that they're not doctored. such that the SMI project can begin to officiate and sanctify which service meshes are in fact compatible with the spec. So that's one of the topics. So the next spec that's kind of under review is the service mesh performance specification. It's a standard for describing and capturing a service mesh's performance. This has participation, this has interest from all of the service meshes that I can prattle off. And Ed, correct me if I'm wrong, as you have your NSM hat on. As a matter of fact, Ed, I'm a little bit afraid of how NSM will sort of blow the doors off of off of the spec.
We're doing a somewhat different thing. It's utterly unfair. It's not an apples and oranges comparison. It's basically an apples to gas giants comparison. Because things that are mind-blowingly performant when you're moving at HTTP, moving packets is just a much easier job.
Yeah, sure. And so that's a good point that Ed raises, is that the spec itself doesn't directly do a comparison, but it facilitates a comparison. So folks can do that with the spec, and they can actually get closer to doing something like that, a comparison.
As a quick side note, though, about the network service mesh thing you brought up there, network service mesh is delighted to participate in things like this to the degree they make sense, but we're deeply committed to not trying to get people to commit unnatural acts that would make these less useful for the intended use cases. So where we can dovetail in, we're delighted to, but we're not here to go tell you, oh, you have to change your spec because we're doing a very, very different thing and we'd like you to include us. We're happy to include where it makes sense, but we really don't want to be blocking real progress.
And that's actually a good, if you don't mind, I'll ask you to characterize that same sentiment toward SMI as a spec.
We absolutely have the same attitude towards SMI. There's a lot of places where SMI, because it's doing a very different thing, it doesn't make sense to either adopt the SMI spec, because again, we're dealing with lower level constructs, nor does it make sense to try and force the SMI spec to handle those lower level constructs in ways that would be really unnatural for it. But we do spend a fair amount of time watching what goes on there and trying to at least draw inspiration from it. Because even if the same spec isn't usable without doing horrible, terrible things to it, which we don't want to do, conceptually we may be able to get close. And concepts make it easier for people to shift their thinking between things.
Yeah, they really do. Yep, that's in part what we're hoping to achieve with this spec, is for people to be able to verbalize and articulate performance characteristics without having to speak four paragraphs of words to describe that. and I had seen some of the work that NSM, the NSM community and the project maintainers had done sort of in diligence of, consideration of SMI and that made a lot of sense that I think if I recall, it was sort of, was there some enhancements in NSM around instrumentation for Prometheus? Yeah, or
we did a bunch of stuff around instrumentations and metrics, where we drew a lot of inspiration from some of the SMI metric stuff. But again, I've been around open source too long, and I've seen too many cases of people who go and try and shove completely insane requirements into a place they don't quite fit. I don't want that to be us. That said, you can learn a hell of a lot from watching people who thought about problems deeply in one domain as you apply them to another, and that we do a lot of.
Sense. Sort of speaking on behalf of this particular spec, I'll earnestly solicit NSM's perspective on the tests that are here and the tests that, like, even to the extent I was mostly joking about NSM kind of blowing the doors off of, and that's in part because the spec should be quite clear about, in fact, what the tests are being. That's actually the point of the spec, is to very clearly articulate what tests are being run in what environments, under what circumstances, so that it's Okay, good. Mm-hmm. So anyway, so there's initiatives that are going, that are proposed within this working group that are relevant to SMI, relevant to SMPS. There isn't one, the last one that we'll talk about is not with respect to Hamlet, but I will talk about Hamlet for a moment, in part because I've been asked, I think twice this week, or once this week, once last week, about this SIG network's inclination to, you know, entertain, either entertain Hamlet as a sandbox project or entertain Hamlet as just a set of discussions and sort of a venue for advancing its, advancing it. So that's a question to the group here. How would you characterize your sentiment toward having Hamlet discussions? I guess in context of this working group, is Hamlet a point of interest for anyone? And a better phrasing of that is, does anyone see that as inappropriate, or does anyone see conflict with Hamlet, or does anyone, think that we shouldn't, that the SIG network shouldn't be spending time and having discussions with Hamlet maintainers? Well, it's okay. And then the last initiative is with respect to performance analysis. And so what we've been talking about here of these service mesh working group initiatives is really a reflection of the fact that there's quite a few service meshes out there. And while it's something of a multi-control plane world, it's almost a single data plane world. Envoy is a super popular data plane, the workhorse, if you will. And Matt, please, I feel awkward characterizing Nighthawk and kind of its genesis and its current use today. But there's sort of in context of Google Summer of Code, there've been discussions for an intern to assist Otto and Jacob with helping on Nighthawk become cognizant of itself or helping it become a bit distributed in nature, such that if there are multiple instances of it running individual performance tests, that it can coalesce, continue to coalesce those results and bring them back into a single location. That's in some respects sort of the gist of this GSOC project. So those are the topics right now that are defined in the service mesh working group. We have previously talked about the service mesh patterns, so sort of best practices around how to do a pattern like zero trust. What does that deployment look like, and canarying, or it really from a user's perspective, what patterns are there? What usage patterns are there? What deployment models are there? There's been kind of asks around that topic as well. It's not identified here, but okay. So that's that topic. I guess the question is, and I guess I would suggest that that's a separate meeting time. But considering that we've had a lull in meeting topics, I guess I figured I would ask the question of the group. Does anyone have a suggestion or perspective as to whether or not those topics are discussed during this meeting time? or discussed at a different time.
I'll weigh in here. One of the things that we are starting to see around some of like the SIGs is that like we are just kind of running out of meeting times that everyone can come to. Turns out 8 a.m. Pacific is like a most popular time. So frankly, I think if you're getting people coming to this particular meeting, looking for a new time that everyone could be like actually available for is more challenging than not. So I'd be inclined to stay here. And if there's enough things that kind of collide and we see that we're not actually getting to everything, then happy to be able to look around at like what other times are available that aren't kind of impacted by just kind of other CNCF meetings. But that's the program manager sitting back going, I think y'all are running out of meeting times.
I completely agree, unless it's like a time zone that, you know, someone that's presenting is, you know, sleeping during that time zone, that time, right? But yeah, I think doing it on meeting time is the right time to do it.
And then Matt or any others have a perspective there? Issues review. All right. Okay. And then there were two other things that I tossed on to the topics just because I considered that one open service mesh was has signaled intentions to try to come into the CNCF, you know, in post haste. So that's just a statement. And then there was a community member who had some. I thought, you know, he had some questions around the use of a C++ client library for what his organization considered that they needed out of a service, out of a quote unquote service mesh. And so Brandon isn't here, says. But for my part, as we look to end in 7 minutes, you know, end early, maybe I'll ask this just because it's something of a point of interest to me is, you know, that there had been a recent set of discussions and an announcement from Google on a, you know, proxyless service mesh using gRPC, you know, essentially using a client library. Did anyone have any commentary on that model, that thought? Is the use of the term service mesh inappropriate there? Is that really just a client library? Are client libraries sort of the generation before a service mesh?
It kind of depends on whose version of service mesh you go with. I mean, if you go to with a classic Asato paper, he very clearly characterized them that way. In fact, two generations back. But I don't think that anybody has the right to speak authoritatively.
Yeah, I chuckle because it just for me personally, I have a deadline on an O'Reilly book on service meshes this week, and it has to address this, or it addresses like what a mesh is. And I always feel like I'm being an arse when I, you know, characterize that as having a, when I characterize that in network planes.
Although, yeah, I mean, what's quite a bit different though about the traditional libraries when you look at what I think is happening with some of the proxyless stuff is it's sort of the triumph of XGS as an API, because they're sort of basically saying part of what was bad about libraries before was that you linked in your particular library and you were not able to interoperate with other things that were not using your particular library. And XGS seems to have arrived at sort of the level of maturity now as an API where it can be used by multiple things. And therefore, the fact that you happen to be using a library doesn't preclude somebody else from using a proxy.
That's a good point.
And so I don't actually have firm opinions yet on kind of what's going on with the gRPC XDS stuff. But that strikes me as one way in which it might be quite different from Casado's characterization of the library approach being a couple generations out of date.
I wonder if this gRPC proxyless approach still, well, almost suffers from lacking the what I would characterize as the core value of a mesh, and that being the decoupling of the empowerment of team.
speaking quite personally and having spent entirely too much time in some of the gRPC implementations, they're already doing an incredible amount inside those client libraries. And I have a slight personal concern. I have a rule of thumb that I refer to as the glomballing rule of thumb, which is when you start trying to dump too much stuff into any one component, the probability that you're making a mistake increases exponentially over time as more and more stuff goes in. And so it doesn't mean that they aren't actually doing something brilliant. Maybe they are. It just means that the probability that something inadvisable happens goes up tremendously.
Sounds like a Unix philosophy or something.
It kind of is. I mean, I've gotten a little humble about it over the years because my experience has been that some of the most brilliant people actually radically violate my rules of thumb. And so like they do a thing that I would normally think would be high probability of being terrible. And they actually found a way to thread the needle and do it brilliantly. So I've gotten a little bit humbler about the rules of thumb over time, but normally trying to do entirely too much in a single monolithic piece is worrisome to me.
Matt, any thoughts on the subject? Proxyless things?
I don't know. No great thoughts that I'm willing to share publicly.
Boy, you were almost hooked there. It was almost, yeah.
Very good. I mean, it's an approach. Whether it's an approach that I think will satisfy a majority of use cases beyond a very, very small cohort is less clear to me. And I don't see how you fix all of the problems that we've had with this approach for years. So I'm not opposed to it. I'm not sure that it's the best use of limited engineering resources.
Well, just a couple minutes left. I'm going to mention this topic only because it weighs on my conscience, and not that I in particular have any bolstering to add here or any, but Watson, thank you for being on the call. I realize that there's been, you know, that we have discussed the cloud native networking principles in the past and we've kind of left it in limbo. And this is why I hesitate to bring it up, because in limbo there it remains. I myself am oversubscribed. I think it's a good, you know, I would leave it to maybe Mr. Owens, Mr. Klein, or, you know, others here to maybe garner some support for these principles and try to shepherd them in and promote them, curate them, you know, assist. And so, it's still up there on the future agenda items. Well, we're at 30 minutes. Anyone have anything else for today? Nice. All right. Very good. Thank you all. See you in a couple weeks. See you soon.
Thanks, Lee. Thanks, Lee.
Just have a great day.
See you.